नमस्कार, सुप्रभात, सुस्वागतम। एंड ऑन बिहाफ ऑफ माय कलीग्स, मी एंड डॉक्टर मिसेस शेवडे वेलकम ऑल ऑफ यू वेरी वार्मली टू दिस वेबिनार। दिस इज अ स्पेशल ओकेजन फॉर अस एट द विवांत एंड टेम दैट फाउंडेशन फॉर अ वैरायटी ऑफ रीजंस। द फर्स्ट इज ऑफ कोर्स दिस इज द फर्स्ट वेबिनार दैट वी आर कंडक्टिंग and it marks our entry into the digital era. Secondly, it is also to celebrate our anniversary. And the important reason that we are doing it with an organization such as BIAF, which is headed by a dynamic individual, Mr. Girish Sohoni, who also happens to be a very dear friend. We are overwhelmed with your response, absolutely. We have a pan-India presence, and I think a fitting tribute to 15th August and the Independence Day celebrations scheduled for tomorrow. We also have international representation, and we have representatives Hello. From Hello. UK, Myanmar, Kenya, and Belgium. We welcome you all too. The spread and the profile of the participants is really amazing. And we have an amazing, wonderful diversity, right from students to farmers, to agriculturists, to academicians, researchers, scientists, NGO representatives, administrators, with one single common thread: the importance of our agri-diversity. I'll give you a small input about how this webinar happened along. We have visited the BIAF Center at Varje, also the one at Uruli Kanchan, and then we had an opportunity to visit Jawahar. We stayed there to experience firsthand the various activities. Needless to say that we were absolutely impressed. Since that time, we've been contemplating having this kind of an event and a program, and it would have been a physical meet. However, for a variety of reasons, it did not happen, and it had to happen today this way, like a webinar. So I'm glad that we are doing this. I'm also going to give you a quick overview about Vivant Untamed Earth Foundation. I see a lot of friends of the Untamed Earth, as we call them, and we welcome all of you to the family of this Friends of the Untamed Earth family. But for those of you who have joined us for the first time, greetings from the Vivant Untamed Earth Foundation, biodiversity, environment, and us. I think that spells our focus. And we believe the us is very important. A quick look at our journey so far. We are a Mumbai-based organization working for the conservation of our biodiversity and environment, chiefly through awareness and education. Our guiding principles are very simple. It is respect and acceptance of biodiversity and its equal rights on our planet, embracing environment-friendly lifestyle and use of environment-friendly technology. And the most important, our role as guardians of this biodiversity heritage for our future generations. Falling in love with our natural world was so natural. And we began to share our joy, but also our concerns. The image or the moment from our natural world was the beginning of a beautiful journey, a step towards insights into this complex web of life. And this was the basis for all our interactions and our activities. They are across age groups, stage groups, with audiences from diverse backgrounds, right from ladies to students to technology institutes to management institutes to corporate entities. in an urban as well as a rural context. We believe that awareness is 90% solution and education is the key, and our focus is urban or the backyard biodiversity. With more and more extreme urbanization, we feel that we have distanced ourselves from our natural world. Our focus is the individual. So we come together, we learn. Somebody will need to mute, please. So our focus is to learn, share, evolve, and importantly, change. Change into an environmentally sensitized individual. Our focus has been always conservation, and there are many parts to this objective. We firmly believe that since we all belong here, each one of us can and must contribute to the cause of conservation based on our individual skills. The paths that we chose to undertake: lectures, presentations, exhibitions, field trails, nature clubs, workshops. We found and decided that students and children will be one of the primary target areas as citizens of tomorrow. So we helped found nature clubs in schools which promote environmental related and biodiversity related activities. There are lectures and presentations that we take across audiences in an urban setting as well as rural setting as described. We also utilized a street play to take a message. And this was done with the inmates of a Mahila ashram. The workshops on composting complemented by urban farming create an end-to-end solution at an individual level. Gradually, this created the path to the lecture series on biodiversity and environment. These lectures touched different aspects of our natural world and were addressed by experts in the field, but importantly, also enthusiast citizen scientists. And that is one thing that we would like to see happening to the common man. Our exhibitions on biodiversity and environment began with the Science Fest organized by a municipal ward. And we had more than 70 schools participating, and they were taken to different locations. A ban on plastic should actually begin with the self and in our mind, not a statute. We don't really know how effective this is. However, we took this as a campaign outdoors to actually promote use of cotton bags, cloth bags, and a complete ban on plastic bags. Our field trails are uniquely designed to reinforce the learning outcomes of our lecturers and teachers. And our focus is to explore our neighborhood first and then go further and farther. So we explore our shores, biodiversity hotspots, including popular areas of Mumbai. Community tree plantation gave us an opportunity to participate in the greening of our neighborhood. However, we firmly believe that the path to a green planet actually begins with one single plant step. And that is an amazing introduction to our urban biodiversity at a macro level. We also had a talk on All India Radio, which dealt with biodiversity and environment predictably. Documentation and presentation, we realized, are very important. We were tracking a heronry of all the places in a central area of Mumbai like Dadar. We tracked it over 3 years, and the findings were appropriately presented on a platform like the conference of the Maharashtra Pakshi Mitra or the conference of the Friends of the Birds. We also reported sightings of very uncommon visitors like the peregrine falcon in our locality, or the nesting of spotted owlets or hornbills to promote observing neighborhood biodiversity. Sagar Masa Sakha, our outreach program on oceans, one of the major undertakings that the foundation undertook in its journey. This was done with the support of the DWOD of the corporation to celebrate our oceans and their rich diversity. The unique feature of this particular program was that it was conducted outdoors on the sands of Girgaon Chowpatty, because we believed and we felt that a subject of such an importance should go to where people are. And what better place than the very popular Girgaon Chowpatty? We had a variety of activities to engage different age groups. So we had drawing competitions and exhibitions and shore walks and lectures. And the drawing competition. What is happening? Is there a problem?
Yes, sir. Actually, we are unable to see your screen, sir.
Can Why is that?
Yes, sir.
So you just show the picture. Shall I? Why is that? We just shared, correct?
No, sir. We are not able to see it, sir.
One sec. You want me to go back?
Yes, sir. You can go back and try to share it again, sir.
Okay. So I will go. You have. One sec. Share screen?
Yes, sir.
Okay. All right. Can you see now?
Yeah. Now it has started sharing. Yes.
Okay. Nice. Is that fine?
Yes, sir. We are able to see the screen, sir.
Yeah. Since we have already heard the story, I'll quickly go through the images, correct?
Yes, sir.
I was audible?
Yeah. You were audible. Excellent. Clearly, sir.
Excellent. So let me quickly jump through to there we are. I'll come right here. Is that fine?
Yes, sir.
It is fine. Not being seen at all. That's okay.
No, sir. No, we were not able to see it, sir. But now we are able to see it clearly, sir.
Okay. So what I'll do is, I will quickly go through this. These are our nature clubs in schools. These are different presentations to diverse audiences. This was the street play that we devised. These are our workshops on composting and urban farming. This is the beginning of our lecture series for diverse topics from our natural world. Here is our exhibition on biodiversity, on environment, basically created for school children, which went to different schools and locations. A campaign on ban plastic use. Our field trails with a focus on neighborhood walks to explore our urban biodiversity. Participation in tree plantations, a talk on All India Radio, documentations of a heronry, presentations on appropriate platforms, tracking uncommon avian diversity, coming to Sagar. So the whole idea was to have diversity of programs to engage different age groups and stage groups. So for the children, we had drawing competition and a rally for oceans. All this was unfolding on the sands of Chowpatty. There were lectures by experts, students, poster presentations, and films on the ocean. And this was at the iconic Wilson College Auditorium. The exhibition on marine world had stunning images from our marine diversity. We are very grateful to all the photographers who contributed. The exhibition again was held on the sands of Chowpatty. The shore walks and the beach cleanup on the Girgaon Chowpatty gave an opportunity to admire the diversity of our marine life, and it also drew attention to the pathetic condition of our shores. And it's all our own doing. The sand art was rendered by students of reputed art colleges from Mumbai, and the sand sculptures were again on Girgaon Chowpatty, one of the highlights of the entire presentation and this year. They were very widely reported, and this drew a lot of participation from our Mumbaikers. The entire objective was very simple. It was to take home the message of marine conservation. Our plan actually was to take Sagar to different coastal locations. Unfortunately, the pandemic put a halt onto everything, but I'm sure a sunrise follows every sunset, and we are looking forward to that particular dawn, which we hope comes soon. With this, I end this brief peep into the world of the Untamed Earth. We invite you to join, like, and connect with us on Facebook. And I shall now take this opportunity to introduce a very dear friend. As we go to the next part of the program, I take this opportunity to welcome a very dear friend, the President and the Chief Managing Trustee of BIOP Research and Development Foundation. Girish, welcome. Suprabhat.
Thank you, Sanjeev.
He is an IITian from Mumbai with mechanical engineering and an alumnus of IIM Ahmedabad. And now he heads BIOP, a national level organization working on rural development and applied research with over 5 million families in 12 states of India. He has a rich and diverse experience of over 40 years in natural resource management and rural livelihoods. He's worked on village production systems and appropriate technology, agribusinesses, and nurturing farmer-produced organizations. He is instrumental in developing BIOP into a multi-sectoral development organization and a resource institution. If I may add, and I'm remembering Girish, I believe this was his first assignment, which he joined as a young graduate, and now he heads that organization almost after 40 years. Obviously, an individual like this with such focus and determination is going to be honored and awarded. And what better award than the one which comes from his own alma mater? He received the Distinguished Alumnus Award 2011 by IITB for his contributions to rural and community development, the Maha Entrepreneur Award 2013, instituted by Praj Industries at the hands of Dr. Anil Kakodkar, and the prestigious Commander of the Order of Agricultural Merit by the Minister of Agriculture, Agri-Foods and Forestry, Government of France. Friends, ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Shri Girish Sohan. Thank you.
Yeah, so thank you so much, Sanjeev. I hope I'm audible. Ram, maybe we can share the screen after the first few minutes.
Okay, sir. Okay. Sure, sir. Yes, sir, if you want to switch on your video, you can do that, sir.
Oh, yeah.
Yes.
Yeah, I hope now you can hear me as well as see me.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Thank you so much, Ram, and thank you, Sanjeev, for the background on Vivant, Untamed Earth. And it is really a pleasure to be with all of you. When we get into this topic for today, which is on agrobiodiversity. I'm just going to speak for a few minutes, an initial introduction on the perspectives of this topic, and also a background of what BIOF is doing and what BIOF has been doing relating to agrobiodiversity conservation. My colleague Sanjay Patil will take us after that through a very elaborate presentation on what BIOF has done in this area, and I'm sure it will be very fascinating to listen to and to watch. Can we share the screen now, Ram?
Yes, sir.
So let me give a little introduction to BIOF and also a few points of perspective on the topic of today. Are we sharing the screen?
Yes, sir.
Okay, I can't see it, so.
Just a minute.
So, as you might be aware, many of you might be aware that BIOF is an organization which is involved in natural resource management and rural livelihoods. We work across the country in a dozen states and reach out to almost 5 million farmers. And all this work has focused on different facets of rural life with a vision to build a self-reliant society, a society which has food security, which has good quality water, good health, proper social norms such as equity of gender, health factors such as low child mortality, a good literacy, and so on. So when we are talking of this vision, boils around the needs of the society as they have been ever since BIOF was established in 1967. So we are already working on this program for well over 50 years now. In fact, the logo of BIOF depicts the principle on which the whole work started. It says Annam Bahukurvita Tatvradam. It's a rucha from the Rigveda, and that is the mission which was set for BIOF and has been pursued for the last 50 years. But while we work on these matters of social development, of rural development, one also realizes that all this work is actually relating to the superstructure. It relates to application of technology, it relates to various program activities that one takes to make a difference to the people in the rural areas who are at a very dire state of living. But while we work on superstructure, it is also important that one looks at the foundations. Ram, can we have the next slide? And when we are talking of the foundations, we are basically saying that the foundations are something which make the superstructure possible, which make the superstructure to survive and sustain. And if the foundations are not preserved and not taken care of properly, then the superstructure, however nice it may look, will crumble sooner or later. And that brings us to another very beautiful hymn from the Atharva Veda, which says, the hymn is called the Ode to the Earth. And it says that whatever I do on top of you, on top of the earth, it should be something which will not damage the basics, which will not damage the foundations. So it says, what I dig out of thee, let it quickly grow over, and let me not damage thy heart or their vitals. I think preserving the foundations of our existence is as important as working on the superstructure to bring about a positive change in the lives of people. Can we go to the next one, Ram? So, what is happening all around us is something which can be concerning. When we realize that we have to work on preserving the foundations, what we see happening around is probably an antithesis of what needs to happen. There is, as you know, an increasing globalization. We talk of the global village now. And when we are having this globalization of existence, it is willy-nilly leading to a lot of erosion of different forms of diversity. This diversity is on different facets of life or of nature. As we all know, the diversity of languages is eroding. Many languages are also becoming extinct. It is not just species becoming extinct. Languages are becoming extinct. Very often, the languages are getting mixed up in the form of a fluid flux, which is creating a sort of a homogeneous language. Maybe at some point of time in future, we will have just one language on the earth. And what happens to all the diversity which has resulted out of various different styles of existence that, you know, were prevailing for thousands of years? Similarly, along with language, it is a manifestation, it is a form in which culture presents itself. So there is a diversity of culture which is also eroding. And we find that in terms of erosions of art forms in the form of artists who can do various things which were possible one or two generations back are no longer possible. So we have this type of a cultural diversity erosion. And all this is happening on top of a more basic erosion of diversity, which is that of biodiversity. We keep reading about how there is a loss of species, how there is a lot of decimation. This is much different than the decimation that occurred in geological time so many times because of natural disasters. This is a decimation, this is an erosion of diversity that is happening because of human action. And that is something which should be a matter of concern. And one facet of loss of biodiversity, the erosion of this biodiversity, is the loss of agricultural biodiversity. What all this implies is something worth looking into. And while we are seeing a lot of loss of these different types of diversity, we must understand that is also is a manifestation of a much deeper loss of diversity in the form of knowledge that we have. All the different peoples of the world in different parts of the world, they have the different bits of knowledge which together make a whole understanding of the universe. There is a lot of diversity loss that is happening there. Ram, let's go to the next one. So if we look at agricultural biodiversity, we, in order to understand what is the relevance of the erosion of that diversity, one must understand what is the role the agrobiodiversity plays in the world, in our civilization, in our life. And does it have a role only of historical significance, or does it have a role for the future? One must realize that different biodiversity loss or different types of diversity of biology, but also of agriculture, represents a very great diversity of gene pool. That means we are saying that there are different species in different parts, different varieties of crops in different parts of the world, which are adapted to particular niches of existence, to particular ecosystems. And this gene pool, therefore, is so diverse that there is a very different type of genetic base that you find for a rice variety that grows in submerged in water, or a rice variety which you find growing in the hill on the hilltops, or a rice variety that you find in very dry conditions, or a rice variety which you find survives in very high temperatures. So you have different niche ecosystems which represent different types of genetic base which makes that crop unique for that. So we are talking of a very diverse gene pool that exists, and it is this gene pool which is actually a resource that is available for any future work that human beings may need to do. Whether human beings use it or not, it is a resource, it is a diversity, it is a resource of genetic variability that is something which is brought life in its evolution to the present point of existence on earth, which makes life something which is able to survive and sustain in the changes that happen in the world. So the gene pool diversity is something, when we talk of loss of agrodiversity, we are saying that a huge gene pool that is available in the world is getting eroded, which means it is not going to be available for the future either as a reference or for nature to take over whenever there are shocks, or for human beings to use when there is a need of using particular genetic base. So as a result of that, we are eroding what is the possibility of sustenance for the future. We also must realize that agrobiodiversity, the species that are diverse in different crop conditions here, also play a role of a keystone. If you don't have a particular type of species suitable in a particular niche condition, then the loss of that, the annihilation of that, can mean that the entire life activity that goes on in that condition can crumble to pieces. The whole thing can come down as an edifice that does not have a keystone to support its structure. So very often species which comprise of the biodiversity and agrobiodiversity function as a keystone to make the rest of them survive and sustain. What it means for the future? We know that there is a tremendous impact of climate change that we see all around us. The effects of it are something which we realize in our daily lives. And we must also realize that for the future, when we say, okay, the temperatures are going to increase, there is going to be a 2 degree or 2.5 degree increase in temperature in certain parts of the country or the world. And there are certain areas which are alpine and which are very cold that are going to become warm. And then there is a difference in precipitation that is going to happen in the future. Some parts, some areas are going to get very heavy rain. Some areas are going to get very extreme weather conditions so often. Then we need things for the human survival which are going to be derived out of whatever genetic resource is available, which can survive under those conditions. And one will have to look at what life forms survive under those conditions, extreme conditions. One has to pick up those type of life forms. If there is a particular crop variety which can survive at 45 degrees and 50 degrees temperature, then one has to pick up those type of crop forms. One has to preserve them. One has to use them for future breeding so that we are able to get the right type of crops which can grow in a high temperature condition. So this type of use of diversity can be the solution, can be the key for ensuring survival for the future. But all these are utility items. What is very important is somewhere we must realize that we are not only the only inheritors of this earth. We are one of the many species that exist on this earth. And having the diversity present is something, a matter of a value. It's something which we must realize, a value that we ascribe to life form, the value that we ascribe to life in general, so that we don't become the monopolistic decimator of everything that exists other than our species. And so we have to find, we have to give an intrinsic value to the concept of diversity. So these are different aspects that one must realize when we are talking of agrobiodiversity as something which is important for us to, you know, accord, you know, importance for the future. Next, please. So when we are talking of these important roles of biodiversity, very often we seek why we have reached this situation. And one of the important reasons why we have reached in this type of a predicament is that we have been emphasizing over the last, particularly last few decades, emphasizing more and more of quantity. All that emphasis was probably driven by a need for survival. There was a time when availability of food grain in the form of cereals was considered almost a big challenge. And then a possibility that the humanity may not survive because of the paucity of available food grains and cereals. And therefore quantity was important. So to grow more, we needed probably, or we put a very misplaced emphasis on the quantity of food grain that is produced. And as a result, we didn't bother about quality. We didn't bother about nutrition. We didn't bother about health. As a result, today we are in a crisis in agriculture where there is a lot of quantity production. We probably, if you take our country, we probably produce much more than what is consumed every year. But at the same time, we also have a great loss of nutrition content in the agriculture output that we produce. So the break between the agriculture and nutrition do not remain actually connected to each other, and this nexus has to be re-established. And when we talk of nutrition and health, that is the expression of quality when we are talking of agricultural produce. So one of the reasons why we have reached this particular situation is because we have been emphasizing quantity, maybe in a misplaced manner, over the last few decades, and not given adequate importance to quality. Next, please. So as we were saying, that we are looking at one aspect of a solution, like quantity, there is a shortage, so you go in for a variety which will produce a high quantity at the cost of other facets and other parameters. So I think it is in this understanding that we must, that there is a very beautiful concept that probably becomes very important. And that concept is that of solving for pattern. Whenever there is a problem to be solved, very often one tends to focus narrowly on a particular problem. And then in trying to solve that problem, one misses out on other aspects, other parameters that probably all have also an important role to play for the future. Like we were talking about the quantity of production. If we are solving the problem of quantity in the form of very high yielding varieties of crops, then probably we are foregoing nutrition. We are foregoing the production of straw along with the cereal. And then there is a production of straw that has been sacrificed. You are not producing enough for the cattle or for the livestock. And therefore you are getting gains in one particular direction and losing out a lot on many other directions. So this is something which goes against the principle of solving for pattern. I think this is a very important concept that one must keep in mind for the future, where we are talking of probably identifying solutions, good solutions, which are good for many purposes. They are not good just for one particular problem to be solved. So one is not talking of only producing, having a high yielding variety which is going to produce millions of tons of rice or millions of tons of wheat, and all that at the cost of, you know, enough fodder, all at the cost of enough nutrition, all at the cost of the diversity that is there in the food basket. And then if we are talking of all these factors also to be taken care of, then one does not think of having a variety which will produce, which will have a good production and a good yield, but also it will be a good production, a good yield in different ecosystems. It will be a diversity of production under different conditions, not just one type of condition. It is producing good quality of food so that there is good nutrition. And it is something which is going to produce all this, which is not at the cost of depleting soils. So one would also have a way by which the crops that are produced, the crops that are grown, are also going to take care of rejuvenation of soils. And all this is not going to be only good for the health of the people who consume, not only good for the health of the livestock which consumes, but also good for the environment. So in trying to find an appropriate solution which is good for one purpose, such as production and yield, one is also ensuring that it has nested goodness qualities which are good for the quality, good in terms of nutrition, good in terms of effect on soils, good in terms of environment. So we are creating a solution which is a solution, good solution of in the nature of a pattern and not in the nature of a very, very specific problem solving. So I think this type of a solving for pattern is something which we need to move to, rather than having a very myopic and narrow focused problem solving approach. And if we do that, then the solving for pattern presents itself as a very important principle on which the concept of agrobiodiversity conservation can become very well entrenched. Next, please. So when we are talking of solving for pattern, then we are talking of actually not only creating a solution which is there in books, not only creating a solution which is in theory, but creating a solution which is in practice and which touches so many different aspects of life. And that is where I am reminded of a very nice quote by Albert Einstein when he talked of knowledge. And he talked of knowledge saying that there are different forms of knowledge. And primarily, knowledge exists in two forms. One is a form in which it exists in libraries, for example. But that is a dead form. It is in the form of books. It is in the form of reports. In today's times, it is in the form of a soft file. It is in the form of a CD. It is in the form of something on the cloud. But all that is a dead form of knowledge. The real live form of knowledge is the form in which knowledge exists in the consciousness of people. This was Albert Einstein. And I think this is a principle that one needs to apply when we try to create new knowledge, when we try to create knowledge which is applied. Like if you are talking of biodiversity, or if you are talking of crops which are combining good yield along with the various goodness factors that I talked about, then it is not enough to just create a report out of it. It is important to create seed out of it. Seed which is conserved, seed which is preserved. And it is not conserved and preserved in a laboratory. It is not conserved and preserved in a gene bank, which is in the form of storage of seed. It should be conserved and preserved in the form of people actually using it, producing it, and practicing it. So that is knowledge in a practice form. And the whole focus of BIOF's conservation program, and Sanjay will talk a lot about that, the whole focus of BIOF's conservation program is to see that it is not knowledge created in a dead form, but it is knowledge created in a living, in a practiced form. And we have done it in various realms of human endeavor. We have worked with Vaidus, who are herbalists from rural communities, who have knowledge of indigenous herbs, and they have knowledge of these medicinal plants and the uses. But it is not just they have this knowledge, which is like a report. It is a knowledge by which they can identify the plant. They know how that plant grows. They know how to preserve that plant. And they create herbal gardens by which this is nurtured. And then it is made use. They know the practice of it, the usage of it. So we have tried to see that there are a lot of Vaidus who are trained, who are involved in the whole usage of herbal knowledge in the form of a practiced art, a practiced science. So that is one area in which the same thing we have done with community resource people who know about application of herbs for curing animals, which is even more difficult because the animal doesn't know how to, cannot tell what is the problem. And the medicine man has still to find out what would be done, what is it to be used as a medicine in order to cure that animal. So we have a lot of such ethno-veterinary knowledgeable persons in rural areas, luckily even now, who have this knowledge. And we are working with them to make sure that it is not only a knowledge which is understood and documented, but it is a knowledge we encourage them to make use of this knowledge and keep it alive, keep it in practice. The same thing is that of seed saviors who are involved in conservation of agrobiodiversity, where we have been able to use the knowledge that these rural communities have to bring together all these different good quality seeds that exist, good quality varieties that exist, and out of that create a program by which interested community members will be involved in not only collecting all that seed, but also in terms of raising their nurseries, in terms of growing them, in terms of selecting them for future regeneration, and then creating a whole movement by which large quantity of good quality seeds of the right varieties, which are important and otherwise which was getting wiped out from the face of this earth, that seed is being used to not only keep on running, but also made available for other people to use in their farms. And that is what the seed saviors have been doing. Sanjay will talk more about it. And equally, we have just initiated work with local craftsmen, local folk artists who have a lot of the diversity knowledge relating to art forms, relating to music, relating to musical instruments, relating to dances, and how this can be kept alive in the form of a practiced form. So these are various ways in which we are trying to see that our conservation program doesn't become a bookish program. It becomes a program where knowledge is preserved in a living and in a practiced form. Next, please, Sanjay, Ram. So when we have these type of seed saviors working on preservation of seed of different varieties, there is one very important benefit or one very important effect that one is having, which is to see that the hegemony of somebody who controls seeds is challenged. Because if you look at the present way of in which seed is made available, we talk of seed being produced commercially, we talk of seed being produced in research labs and then multiplied by commercial companies and, you know, made available as a commercial product. But this was not the case 50 years back. 50 years back, 100 years back, there was hardly any production and trading of seed, branded seed. All seed was produced locally. All seed was produced by individuals who were involved as seed saviors, and they were the ones who were exchanging seed and making it available. Good quality varieties were there across the country, which was being used. And today, all that, with the erosion of the diversity of seeds, the erosion of this system of seed production and exchange has also happened. So what is happening is, when you are doing work with seed saviors, when you are trying to work on the conservation of seed of different varieties, you are also simultaneously recreating the system by which seed was being produced locally, decentralized manner, according to the local conditions, and then made available for local exchange. So that gets restored. And we have to see that this system gets nurtured for the future also. Next, please. So that is the form which the BIOF program takes of seed conservation. It is individual varieties of seeds which are produced, which are available to the rural communities in remote areas, which are brought together, which are used to produce good quality seed, and then conserved and then preserved and multiplied and exchanged. But it is not just about crops, agriculture crops. Our program not only takes care of agriculture crops, but we also work on tree crops. On the right side, you see a tree, which is a mahua tree, which is very important in tribal areas. And this is a mahua tree which has unique characteristics. For example, this one flowers twice in a year, where generally it would be only once in a year. And then what we have done is, we have brought in newer techniques, modern techniques of science and technology. We have been working on characterizing these type of agrobiodiversity to understand it in terms of scientific principles, to understand it in terms of what is the genotype, to understand in terms of what is the genetic signature of each of these varieties, but at the same time, creating a way by which it is preserved and nurtured by the local population. You see in the middle picture at the top, there are a number of youth there who are preparing grafts made from mahua. And they have used these type of special trees and used the bud sticks and created mahua grafts, which they now make available to large number of farmers who would be interested in planting them in their fields. And you can see the nursery growing below. So we have worked on agriculture crops, we have worked on biodiversity of livestock, we have worked on biodiversity of tree crops. So the whole agrobiodiversity conservation program is trying to create a movement by which large number of people, number of communities in different parts of the country would be involved in creating and preserving something for posterity as well as for their own needs. Next, please. So this is what we have been doing. And I think all this adds up to a solution, which is a solution for a pattern. It is not a solution for one particular problem. It is a solution for a pattern. And what we have seen happening all around is that, in a small way, it is not only contributing to only one dimension of existence, that is human well-being. Simultaneously, we are seeing that all these efforts are also leading to an ecosystem well-being happening. So probably this is a program which makes possible, for the first time, simultaneous improvement in the well-being of human beings as well as ecosystems. And that is what we need to have as a future direction if we want to tide over the present problems that have been created over primarily the last 50 to 100 years. And then if we want to create a solution which will also be able to be relevant and applicable in situations such as this pandemic and beyond. With that, I would stop in presenting our perspectives, but I'm sure what Sanjay will present will give you a lot of concrete information on all these different facets of the Agro Biodiversity Conservation Program that BIOF is implementing. Thank you so much.
I'll just hand it over back to Dr. Sanjeev Shevde. Just a minute. Yes, sir.
Thank you. Thank you, Girish. I think it was the perfect opening to what we hope will follow, not just in the course of today's webinar, but in the days to come with participation of such a wonderful audience. We are looking forward to it. Thank you so much. And now, with this backdrop, as presented by Girish Soni, the president of BIOF, we go to the next important part of today's program, and we are welcoming Sanjay Patil. Sanjay, are you there, please?
Yes, sir. I'm just trying to unmute him.
Yeah. A very wonderful introduction of this gentleman. He is the thematic program executive at BIOF. And he's been with BIOF in this capacity for over 15 years. Very interestingly, he is with a bachelor's degree in chemistry, and then he has his chemical technology qualification from the illustrious Institute of Technology, or formerly the University Department of Chemical Technology, UDCT as we call it. His main areas of interest are indigenous traditional knowledge, ITK, and indigenous crop diversity. The need and importance of indigenous crops for livelihood and nutritional security, which Girish has so beautifully explained. Scientific studies on nutrition and agromorphological aspects. Development of community management programs for seed conservation. Legal aspects associated with crop diversity. Grassroots genome saviors, the real saviors of agrobiodiversity. In fact, anything and everything in their diverse perspectives as far as seed conservation goes. So, ladies and gentlemen, let us all welcome Sanjay Patil and listen to his real life experiences. Thank you so much, Sanjay. Over to you.
Just a minute, sir. I'm just trying to unmute him. Just a moment.
We are very happy to see the participation. And one of the aspects of this particular webinar was that we look at this webinar as a stepping stone to a lot of wonderful things that we hope will follow. We will invite your thoughts, your suggestions on this particular topic in the days to come, and and act on them. Sanjay, there you are. Thank you so much.
Yes, sir. Sorry for the confusion. Over to you, sir. Yes, sir. We are able to see your screen.
Hindi bhi aayegi. Please don't. There was a request about use of Hindi as also. So I'm sure you'll mix Hindi and English together. Thank you.
It's a good opportunity from Untamed Earth Foundation and BIOF. This organized this webinar on indigenous seeds, as Mr. Girish Soni, sir, President BIOF, already discussed about overview of role of indigenous crops and diversity for food, nutrition, and climate change. So, without wasting time, I'm going directly to the subject on which we are going to discuss. Here in today's presentation, I am going to cover the need and importance of indigenous seeds for the issues which we are facing, and then role of BIOF and what BIOF has done in last 12-13 years in different tribal blocks of Maharashtra, and then how we go ahead with these understanding and the work already done, and how we can make these a program on bigger scale involving masses for the benefit of masses. So I am audible? मेरे आवाज आ रही है सबको?
हाँ हाँ हाँ
Yeah, so this is my first slide. Here itself gives the prosperity and diversity entering in the home. This is now we are seeing this. This is the diversity of food available in that house. So in tribal and rural parts of country, at present also, there will be called as the toran, where diversity of different crops hanged after harvesting harvesting of different crops. So for me, agriculture, the definition of agriculture for me is something different than FAO and agriculture, existing agriculture system. Agriculture means agri plus culture, as Mr. Girish Soni sir already discussed about the culture. Culture doesn't mean only one word, but food culture, diversity, habitats, then community knowledge, wisdom, everything exists in a culture. So we have to take this definition now, as agriculture means agri plus culture. And there are two definitions of seed and soil, as seed is the soul of agriculture and it is a resource of the community. Since years and ages, communities from tribal rural parts and this farming community has conserved this diversity, and so that's why it's called as a soul. If there is a seed, there is a food, and there is a food security. So we have to conserve, revive, and use it sustainably, this seed. And about the soil, soil means soul of infinite life. In definition of soil itself, cover all the aspect related to agriculture, biodiversity, human, then animals, everything covered in that soil aspect. So these three definitions are giving overview of the biodiversity and existing system and traditional knowledge behind this diversity. So, sir, journey of seed, must all of you know about this, but still I am presenting this. There are wild relatives, then cultivars and land races selected by the communities, and thousands of years of selection we are getting these cultivars and land races, and as per the end use, as per the specific recipe, any medicinal importance, and on that basis, even climatic situation, drought resistant, deep water crop varieties, and then some new rice for delivery weakness, rice as an instant energy supplier. As these number of selections comes through experience of the farming communities, and these experiences not of 10-5 years, hundreds of years of experience, and from that through keen observation of tribal and rural communities and these farming communities, all this diversity came into picture. That's why in rice it has been known that more than 1.5 lakh cultivars or land races selected by the community since years and ages. That's why the diversity exists, and it is only because of the wisdom and knowledge of these communities and end use. That's why diversity into use is very much important than as Girish Soni sir told about the statement that knowledge of biodiversity cannot be locked in in books, reports and museums and in seed bank. It should be a live program with the communities involving. So that is very much important. And then after that, from the after cultivars, there are selection varieties as per the need and to improve the yield and all other specific as per the need, the drought stress tolerant, drought tolerant, dwarf genotypes. These are the selection. After that, improved and hybrids, and after that, genetically modified crops. So this is the journey of seed diversity. Just I am going telling about the picture which I had put here on the right side. That is a wild rice known as a God's rice or Dev Bhat. In Marathi, it is known as a Dev Bhat. Dev Bhat means Bhagwan ka rice. So still in tribal and rural parts, hilly regions where there is some pond, this rice exists, and this is the wild relative of rice. So if you see the on of that rice, so it is too long and even surface is very much rough. And from that, like these, there are number of selections from these wild rice has been done and number of rice varieties came into exist. So from wild relative to cultivar to selection to improved and hybrids and then modified crops. So this is the whole journey of indigenous seed. Just I'm going to take a brief overview of biodiversity of India. And all of you know, India is one of the mega diversity center, and in Havilah database, India is among 8 centers of origin of the world. And India has more than 49 species of different plants, fungi and other. That means 11% of world's flora is in India. So that's why it is in different parts, different region, different agroclimatic situation. There are different systems exist. So one solution for all, it is not possible in India at least. So that's why there is a diversity of food, diversity of indigenous crops, varieties, everything. And these varieties has been developed, land races and ecotypes through selections, as I told. If you see the picture on right side, from 4 lakh species estimated worldwide, and now and among that 3 lakh documented, 30,000 edible, 7,000 utilized, and we have only database, statistical database of 200 crops only till now worldwide, and among that 30 feeds worlds, and 3 are the major, that is rice, wheat and maize, and about 65% of our food plate is full of these 3 crops. That means as this triangle becoming narrowing, the issues are increasing. We have no solution for climate change situation, nutritional security. जैसे ये plate narrow होते जा रहा है, जैसे triangle narrow हो रहा है, वैसे ही हमारी food plate narrow हो गया. And food plate narrow होगी, तो issues, health issues, nutrition issues are coming up. So this is very much important triangle which shows the diversity, narrowness of diversity and the issues we are facing. So as Sony sir and also Shevde sir there is a need to conserve the wisdom associated with the diversity. Only collection of seeds and conservation will not serve our purpose. So because this is a heritage of humankind, and then it is a foundation for food, nutrition and health. And these just I told regarding the evolution, that means through evolution, number of genotypes, ecotypes are in the nature, but through keen observation of these grassroots farmer scientists, selected, used as per need and even multiplied on large scale. So at present, we have very less options for climate resiliency, biotic and abiotic stresses, therapeutic uses, but still in tribal and rural parts, these diversity, number of crops and their land races are eroded already, but still number of things exist with them. Then this indigenous traditional knowledge about the culture and diversity, because culture is not something different from these biodiversity aspect, because there are festivals of agrobiodiversity in different parts of a country, different religions and even different tribal communities. If you see the picture at the middle, this is a photograph from one of the location in Maharashtra. It's a Nandurbar district. There is a festival called Astamba Festival. festival. Astamba means Ashwathama, and since years that festival, and lakhs of people from different Madhya Pradesh, Maharashtra and Gujarat coming over there at Diwali time, and they are offering seed to that Astamba, and that may, and there is an exchange of seed among farming communities, and there was a discussion about that. So this is the real festivals of biodiversity, and this is a real share and exchange within the communities, within the regions, for creating variability and selecting best types and use it for consumption and then for use, different uses. So there is need to protect the systems associated with this diversity. Then last photograph is of when there is one painting. This is whole system of rice cultivation in Kokan belt of Maharashtra has been put in a warli painting, that one seed to harvest, harvest to post harvest, and this is a live picture. At each and every part of this picture tell a story something, and it is a whole system of cultivation, traditional cultivation practices in that. So the question is, why indigenous seed? So just we discuss the risk mitigation. We have very less option. We need stress tolerant deep water varieties. We seed nutritionally rich crops because food as a medicine concept is coming again. Food as a poison previous now, and then now we need a food as a medicine. Calcium rich rice, iron rich, antioxidant rich, anti-diabetic food, and this still exists in these diverse crops and varieties. And again, livelihood, how we can create a livelihood, and it's possible to create a livelihood through indigenous crop cultivation, conservation and management. And again, the question of sovereignty, because seeds are not in the hand of farmers now, it is in the hands of someone else. So how we can use this indigenous diversity for broad-based diversity and make these things open to all, which was exist earlier. So these are some photographs from different tribal belts of Maharashtra. Through selection, upgradation, these indigenous varieties are again in large scale cultivation from different areas of Maharashtra. So the issue is not only local, the issue is not only global, issue is local to global. That means we have to work with these communities, scientific communities we need, then farmers we need, students, every stakeholder who eat the food, we need to be in this picture to work on these issues. So globally around 75% crop diversity already been lost, but still there are number of crops exist. We have to collect, conserve, multiply, use it sustainably. Issue of malnutrition is there, and there is no packaged food. Packaged food is not a solution for malnutrition. How we can diverse the crop system, cropping, how we can revive cropping system in different parts. So right hand side picture, in centuries, what we can lose. First is on the top, century ago, 1903. This was the diversity, but after 80 years, the cabbage diversity has been lost to 36. Then muskmelon diversity from 388 to 27. So in all crops, these things happen worldwide. Then again, question of diversity versus monocrop. हमने एक exercise लिया था school के बच्चों के साथ. उनको बताया कि you can go in your home, ask grandfather and grandmother कि आप क्या खाते थे. That is plate number one. Plate number two, आप आपके father and mother के साथ बैठिए and you can ask them what they are eating at their young age. And third plate by students, मैं क्या खा रहा हूँ, what I am eating today. And it has given the things, just I want to inform regarding that in the plate of grandfather and grandmother, 41 types of foods atoms, and it is in region wise, season wise, there is a diversity. And then in father and mother plate, it comes to around 23, and in the plate of student, it is only 7 or 8 items, and it is not a diversity. So diversity law, monocropping and monovarietal cropping, we are losing everything. So there is need to conserve this diversity and broad-base this genetic resource. Crop failure and risk associated with the uniformity, we everyone know. Koi ek pest aa jata hai, thousands of acre of land hamara disease infect ho jata hai. But if there is a diversity, it's possible to get something and reduce the risk associated with this. So now worldwide we have to think on quintals per hectare or nutrition per hectare. If we see these अभी ये पिक्चर यदि देखेंगे मिलेट्स अभी इन ट्राइबल एंड रूरल पार्ट्स ऑफ कंट्री मिलेट यानी जिसको भरड़ धान्य भी मराठी में बोलते हैं तो अभी ये देखिए अभी हमें सिर्फ फिंगर मिलेट रागी ही पता है नहीं तो फॉक्सटेल मिलेट राड़ा पता है बट दीज आर डिफरेंट क्रॉप्स विच आर existing these millets and millets are rich source of nutrition. यदि देखेंगे अभी just simple एक example हम ले लेते हैं. In rice there is 0.2% fiber है rice में. And then in case of कोडो millet 9% fiber. So हम अभी क्विंटल पर हेक्टर की तरफ से हमारी सोच न्यूट्रिशन पर हेक्टर जाना बहुत ही जरूरी है. एंड देन फॉर दैट हमें ये सारे क्रॉप्स फिंगर मिलेट ऑक्सटेल मिलेट लिटल मिलेट बार्नेट मिलेट कोडो मिलेट नीड टू रिवाइव दिस डाइवर्सिटी अगेन. एंड क्लाइमेट चेंज दीज आर द क्रॉप्स फॉर द फ्यूचर इन क्लाइमेट चेंज सिचुएशन. FAO हैज ऑलरेडी डिक्लेयर दीज आर द फूड फॉर फ्यूचर एंड क्रॉप्स फॉर द फ्यूचर. So again, अभी ऐसा भी देखा जा रहा है कि all worldwide there were gene banks. In India there is National Bureau of Plant Genetic Resources. CG Center already conserved more than 7.5 million. इतने सारे origins ये gene bank में पड़े. जैसे गिरीश सोनी सर ने बताया कि knowledge and resources should not be locked in books, reports and these museums or these gene banks. There is a definitely great role of the gene bank, but now it is limited. Now we have to think beyond that, and as per the need we have to develop the on-farm system involving communities in participatory. We have to develop the program. So these are the on-farm level conservation. So Biodiversity International, even National Agriculture Seed System focus is diverting from ex situ to in situ, again involving communities. So through 13 years of our work, this is our approach, that is conservation involving communities, cultivation involving communities, consumption in their food plate, how we can diversify their food plate of farming communities, and then for all again, and commercialization for getting some good income and livelihood opportunity. That is conservation through use. It is not just laboratory level research, but or genomic level research. In all type of research activities involving these communities, we are doing at the field level. And this is firstly the on-farm conservation center where farmers are coming. This is as like a research station at the field in the land or on the land of community. So it is live gene bank in the field. This is the seed production involving tribal women. Then diversification in food plate, and then market, developing market linkages. So this is our approach of conservation. So this work start, BIOF has started work in 2008 and 9 in Jawar tribal block where Warli tribal communities, and then in Nandurbar district where there is a Paura tribal communities, and Itapalli and Bhamragad, this is another Gond and Madia tribal community, Ahmednagar Akkole. This is so different agroclimatic zones of Maharashtra covered under this, and conserve this diversity involving communities on the place where that exists. So this is after 12, 13 years of work, this is our model of conservation, how we can do these things in participatory manner, in scientific approach, and then involving communities. So I am going to going in details of this in next slide. So iska structure kya hai gaon ke level pe seed saver, seed producer, then seed saver groups, and then community seed bank. This is a village level system. And again, at institution level structure system, there is a cluster level seed bank. Again, through support of Maharashtra government, that is Maharashtra Gene Bank program, developed the ex situ gene bank at Baya Pune. As I mentioned, there is a need of both system, though we are not focusing only on ex situ, or we are not only dependent on in situ. Both simultaneously we are doing, and farmers are depositing the germplasm in the seed bank, and there is a agreement between farmers that we are giving this sample to this, and BIF has already declared that we are just facilitator and supporter to conserve this diversity, and we will not claim any IP or patent or rights on these resources. So this is the one of the unique approach to support the community and develop a livelihood and other opportunities as farming communities is facing. This is ex situ gene bank. This is centrally the cluster level gene bank. And third is the community level seed bank. And we had a good link with government institution at national level, state level, and then regional level, involving these communities. So at present, these are the seeds of hope and seeds of future. Why I am telling this? Because from last 12-13 years of work, we had collected this diversity. We had done scientific evaluation of more than 300 crop cultivars, morphologically, agronomically, and then nutritionally, and again even genomic level studies we had initiated. So if we see the diversity of maize, this is from Nandurbar district of Maharashtra, where Paura tribal community, and each one has something different in end use. This is a red rice diversity. The color is after removing of us, it's looking similar, but each one has some different properties. Crop period wise, it is different. Resiliency point of view, each one different. End use wise also, there is a variability. In case of sorghum also, same thing. So these are the real scientists. If you have seen these, you may have seen these women. Ye hai Padmashri Rai Bai Popere, who is from Akole tribal region and from Mahadev Koli tribal community. In 2014, हमारी टीम वहाँ पे विजिट किया एंड कलेक्टेड एंड डॉक्यूमेंटेड मोर देन 25 स्पेसीज ऑफ डिफरेंट क्रॉप्स, जिसमें राइस, मिलेट्स, बीन्स, वेजिटेबल्स था. एंड इनका इट इज नॉट जस्ट डाइवर्सिटी बट नॉलेज एसोसिएटेड विथ ईच जीनोटाइप. सो अभी गवर्नमेंट ऑफ इंडिया ने इनको पद्मश्री डिक्लेयर किया है. सो ऐसे ग्रास रूट इनोवेटर इन डिफरेंट पार्ट्स ऑफ कंट्री आज भी है. सेकंड फोटोग्राफ जो दिख रहा है, यहाँ देर इज नो एनी कोड नंबर, लैंड रेस कोड नंबर और एनी मॉर्फोलॉजिकल डेटा, बट जब 2014-15 में ये वुमन मुझे एक मार्केट में मिली, जहाँ पे वो बेच रही थी स्मॉल पैकेट्स ऑफ सीड्स. यहाँ पे मोर देन 65 डिफरेंट वेजिटेबल क्रॉप्स है, एंड सी नोज everything about this crop period, resiliency, and then end use. So ye hamare aise grassroots innovator humne identify kiye from different tribal regions of Maharashtra, and these are the real heroes. And इनको इनके इनका इनका नॉलेज और इनको साथ में लेके the program has been designed around them, and now it has become an organization in different parts of Maharashtra. So, जैसे देखा गया कि फार्मर ज्यादातर रिसर्च में इंटरेस्ट नहीं लेते, उनको कुछ पता नहीं है, ये हमारी सोच है. लेकिन ये ऑन फार्म कंजर्वेशन सेंटर से हमें पता चला कि सीइंग जब लोग देखते हैं, डेफिनेटली दे कैन कंट्रीब्यूट, एंड उनको पता है व्हाट देयर नीड्स. सो ऐसे कंजर्वेशन सेंटर डिफरेंट पार्ट्स ऑफ महाराष्ट्र विद इन द रीजन, जो भी डाइवर्सिटी है कंजर्व करने के लिए, ऐसे फील्ड लेवल के ऑन फार्म सेंटर होते हैं, जहाँ पे ये ऑल क्रॉप डाइवर्सिटी एज पर द साइंटिफिक नॉर्म्स एंड इन्वॉल्विंग कम्युनिटीज यहाँ पे सब किया जाता है. एंड एक्सपोजर टू फार्मिंग कम्युनिटी, स्टूडेंट्स, रिसर्चर्स यहाँ पे किया जाता है. एंड देन ब्रॉड बेस्ड सिलेक्शन ऑफ बेस्ट जीनोटाइप फ्रॉम दैट एंड मल्टीप्लाई एंड लार्ज स्केल एंड अदर अंडर कंजर्वेशन थ्रू इंस्टीट्यूशन. या at each and every stage of these agrobiodiversity related work, starting from mapping to purity maintenance to varietal selection and seed production and grain storage, at every stage involvement of community. Hame bataya gaya ki it is very difficult to work on maize because it is highly cross-pollinated crop, but these are the tribal community farmers from Paura tribal community. They are doing selping, bagging, and they are expert. They have developed the 5 different varieties from selection और अभी है under registration है. और एक good news अभी है, last week उसमें से 3 varieties को protection of plant varieties ने registration certificate दे दिया है. So ये photograph जो दिख रहे हैं, single plant selection, mass selection, bagging, selfing, and then selection, then participatory variety selection among different genotypes. So ये सारे exercise in the field with the communities हमारी team करती है. Yeah, school as a center of development, school as a center of biodiversity. हमें पता चला, हमें लगा कि अभी ये सारा काम तो लोगों के साथ चल रहा है, लेकिन how we can penetrate this message of diversity in the schools with the students. तो ये भी काम हमने initiate किया है, developing on farm conservation center at school land, then awareness program, seed germination. Even these students are doing the morphological evaluation. So maths, physics, chemistry, botany, everything they are learning in the field. This is on-farm learning center for them. And the collection of diversity and knowledge associated with these, this has been done through students' involvement. So there are some good types, around 50 to 55 types are under large scale promotion. This is one variety, Gundi, which has a yield of around 50 to 55 quintal, which is compared to hybrid without using any chemical fertilizers. You know, even in little millet, foxtail millet, barnyard millet, maize, sorghum, there are a number of genotypes which are under thousands of acre cultivation and promotion through self promotion through farming communities. Yeah. We have to work on creating variability. So that work we had initiated in Jawar block, because there is very less diversity among the millets, developed varieties in the millets. So we had initiated this program in at Jawar block, and we had now selected around 55 different single plants having variability, because abhi hame chahiye variability to work early, late, mid late, good yielding, then stress tolerant, so in different type, and this maintenance related and rehabilitated work started at village level involving women and men party farming participants. So this is ऐसा भी एक चीज हुआ कि 2012-13 में मुझे एक राइस का सैंपल मिला था, अराउंड 10-15 सीड्स. So I had gone through literature and I had got this rapid clonal multiplication, जो डॉक्टर रिचरिया जी ने डेवलप किया हुआ टेक्निक, कि हमारे पास 10-15 सीड्स भी होंगे तो वी कैन मेक इट इन क्विंटल्स. So this is rapid clonal. So there is need to save every genotype exist, which is exist. So rice as a medicine. So rice is not only a staple food, but it is a medicine. In Ayurveda, there are a number of rice varieties mentioned. So we had collected these different rice genotypes from different tribal blocks of Maharashtra, and we are doing scientific research on that. So rice as an instant energy supplier, Mahadi as a rice for delivery weakness, Malgudia is a rice given to lactating mother, liquid gruel of these Rajgudia given to nursing mothers, then animal energy supplementary rice, then Khadkya, which is rich in mineral, Wale used for fever and weakness. So like these, there are number of genotypes which has some medicinal and functional value. So there is need to go in detail and in-depth research of these, because it will create a good market for tribal communities, and along with that, good nutritious food to all. अगेन इश्यू ऑफ क्लाइमेट चेंज. अभी हमारे हाथ में बहुत कम रिसोर्सेस है विच कैन ग्रो इन दिस टाइप ऑफ कंडीशन, दिस बीन टाइप नोन एज कडुवाल विच कैन ग्रो इन हार्श कंडीशन हाई टेम्परेचर. दिस राइस वैरायटी जैसे पानी बढ़ता है द वैरायटी कैन ग्रो. So in deep water around 1.5 meter water still it exists, survive and give a good yield. Kalbhat which can give a good yield in stress situation. So like these there are number of crops identified and now it is under testing and promotion. So there are some interesting rice varieties we had collected from tribal. इसको बोला जाता है नजर बात. मैंने लिखा भी है यहाँ पे किसी की नजर न लगे. नजर means eyesight and किसी की नजर न लगे. इसलिए at the middle of rice plot farmers putting some put few seedlings of these. But it has some medicinal properties also. Liquid gruel used for this Newcastle disease in poultry. So, जैसे मैंने बोला कि ये रिसोर्सेस कैसे डिसअपीयर हो गए, व्हाई इट इज एग्जिस्ट एंड व्हाई डिसअपीयर्ड. सो ये भी बहुत इंपॉर्टेंट है. अभी ये सोरगम की वैरायटी डिसअपीयर होने का कारण जो है वो आपके लिए शायद थोड़ा अलग लगेगा, क्योंकि जैसे जैसे ये ट्राइबल कम्युनिटी ने उनके घर बनाने के तरीके एज पर द मॉडर्न सिस्टम्स शुरू किए सीमेंट कंक्रीट वाले, तब ये वैरायटी खत्म हो गई उसकी वजह से. तो आप सोचेंगे कि ये हाउस कंस्ट्रक्शन यानी सोरगम वैरायटी का रिलेशन क्या है. अभी ये जो वैरायटी है टॉल ग्रोइंग है, देन स्टेम इज वेरी स्ट्रांग, देन ऑयलीनेस ऑन स्टेम. तो ये इसका स्ट्रॉ यूज होता था हाउस वॉल कंस्ट्रक्शन के लिए. अभी वैसे हाउस ही बनने बंद हो गए और उसकी वजह से ये वैरायटी अभी नामशेष और लुप्त होने के कगार पे है. And it has some good nutritious value. इसका liquid gruel used as an instant energy supplier. तो ऐसे भी types है. तो diversity loss के लिए not only hybridization और improved varieties responsible है, ऐसे बहुत सारे अलग issues भी है जिसकी वजह से ये diversity loss हो रही है. चिकनी जॉर्ज जिसको अभी प्लांट प्रोटेक्शन वैरायटी से लास्ट वीक सर्टिफिकेट आ गया, तो इसकी खासियत क्या है. दिस इज सोरगम वैरायटी फ्रॉम नंदुरबार डिस्ट्रिक्ट ऑफ महाराष्ट्र. सो इसमें स्टिकीनेस बहुत ज्यादा है एंड इट इज वेरी डिफिकल्ट टू प्रिपेयर अ रोटी फ्रॉम दिस एंड बट इट इज गुड फॉर पापड एंड सिंस इयर्स दिस कम्युनिटी इज यूजिंग फॉर दैट. तो और स्ट्रेस टॉलरेंट है, इंस्टेंट एनर्जी सप्लाई है. तो अभी इट इज अंडर लार्ज स्केल कल्टीवेशन. आई हैड गॉट अ सिंगल पेनिकल इन 2010, नाउ इट इज ऑन 25 एकर्स ऑफ लैंड. अगेन हाउ वी कैन डाइवर्सिफाई अ फूड प्लेट इन ट्राइबल एंड रूरल एरियाज. तो कम्युनिटी सीड बैंक्स through vegetable seed conservation. More than 155 landraces of indigenous vegetable collected from different areas. And this is a case story of one of a location where there was we had collected different varieties of vegetable. And now it has इसे अभी एक community enterprise खड़ा हो गया. And the sale of 9.9 lakh रुपीज किचन गार्डन किट फ्रॉम दिस वुमेन्स इन डिसेंट्रलाइज्ड फॉर्म. यहाँ पे कोई सेंटर नहीं है, कुछ नहीं है, घर के लेवल पे देयर दिस वुमेन आर डूइंग क्लीनिंग, देन फिजिकल प्यूरिटी, देन इवन जर्मिनेशन परसेंट एंड देन पैकेजिंग ऑफ दिस सीड्स. एंड इट हैज अ ग्रेट वेरी गुड मार्केट इन अर्बन गार्डनिंग ऑल्सो. सो ऐसे बिजनेस इसमें से अभी तैयार हो रहे हैं. So validating tribal knowledge. In 2016 एक पुणे के नजदीक जुन्नर ट्राइबल ब्लॉक है जहां महादेव कोड़ी ट्राइबल कम्युनिटी, उनके साथ हम डिस्कस कर रहे थे कि आप क्या खाते हैं. यहाँ का अम्बेमोर बहुत फेमस है. अम्बेमोर सबको शायद पता होगा. अम्बेमोर वन ऑफ द यूनिक राइस वैरायटी फ्रॉम महाराष्ट्र. लोगों से जब पूछा दे टोल्ड वी आर नॉट ईटिंग अम्बेमोर रेगुलरली, वी आर ईटिंग खड़किया इन अवर डेली कंजम्पशन. तो why they told that it gives the energy and we cannot work in the field by eating ammemohar. So खड़किया is the best choice for us. So if we had done a nutritional profiling of all these varieties, so if we see the comparative of these mineral composition of Ambe Mohra and Khadkia, Khadkia is rich in sodium, Khadkia is rich in iron, Khadkia is rich in potassium, even calcium, and then zinc. So validation of community knowledge through scientific tools. अभी यहाँ पे जो photograph दिख रहे हैं ये Khadkia rice है and then नीचे का जो है Ambe Mohra rice है. So, शायद people from Mumbai know about this variety, Vadakkolam. There are number of brands in Vadakkolam, but really we are eating original Vadakkolam. I say it's no, because only वहाँ पे Vada region में around 40 to 45 farmers है, they are growing Vadakkolam. Others, it is not a Vadakkolam. But in the market, all over the country, even दूसरे countries के mall में भी Vadakkolam brand मिल रहा है. तो ये Vadakkolam आया कहाँ से? It is a duplicate of Vadakkolam. So we had collected around 25 accessions of Vadakkolam from Vadakkolam from Vada region of Maharashtra, it's in Konkan region, and now we are doing research work on that, and we are supporting farming communities for GI tag. Again, we had started work on wild edibles. It is possible we had done documentation of more than 173 wild edible plants, and it is in habitat, end use, recipes, any medicinal importance. All these information we had collected, organized field level, these wild food festivals at village level and even urban level, and started work on conservation of these wild food diversity, then promotion of these seedlings through nurseries. Shayad inko apne dekha hoga, he is one of the person who inspired masses, the person who has developed through selection HMT rice, jo abhi more than 1 or 2 lakh farmers from different parts of country are using, cultivating these rice. It is a selection from Patel 3. So there are a farmer breeder who teaches us a lot, and ye hamare guru jaise kaam kar rahe the. Abhi two year back he was not abhi nahi hai hamare saath mein. To inhone jo variety develop kiya hai, which has yield of 40 to 45 quintal. To aise grassroots innovator aaj bhi hai. There is a need to support these individuals and group of farmers to develop these varieties, conserve these, multiply it, and make it on a large scale. So, हमारे program में भी ऐसे दो innovator मिले जिन्होंने खुद through selection new variety develop किए हैं. एक है अश्विनी, second है कमल, साधना एंड कीर्ति. These are some unique rice variety. अभी ये rice variety है साधना, around 12 days ये rice crop पानी में था, still it has given a good yield. And in case of Ashwini also, it is a stress tolerant, non-lodging, good yielding, good tillering ability, non-shattering variety. So through selections, these farmers have developed these variety, and इनको government of India ने national genome award से भी ये किया है, सम्मानित किया है. तो ऐसे grassroots innovators, youth को support करना, उनको थोड़ा technical information देना, और उसके साथ they can develop their own skill and they can develop something good for community. So, अभी ये सारी चीजें मार्केट के साथ भी जोड़ने का काम शुरू किया है, द यूनिक राइस वराइटीज लाइक Khadkia, कालभात, वाले, सो दैट फार्मिंग कम्युनिटीज कैन गेट अ गुड प्रीमियम प्राइस टू दीज, एंड दिस इज अ कम्युनिटी ब्रांड. बायफ इज सपोर्टिंग फॉर कलेक्शन, प्रोडक्शन एंड डेवलपिंग मार्केट लिंकेजेस. So, अभी आगे की सोच क्या है? BIOF is planning now, from last 13 years we have done this work, developed some approach. Now we are planning to give a facilitative support to organizations, individuals in different parts of the country, so that they can also develop their program in their location for conservation and management of this diversity, upscaling of good genotype, and make it a broad base for the benefit of all. then clinical laboratory level and molecular level studies still need to do on in depth. तो वो काम करना बहुत ही जरूरी है. डेवलपिंग मार्केट लिंकेजेस एंड डेवलपिंग प्रोडक्ट नीच प्रोडक्ट फ्रॉम दिस डाइवर्सिटी दैट इज आल्सो वन ऑफ द इम्पोर्टेंट वर्क विच वी आर प्लानिंग इन फ्यूचर. देन स्ट्रेंथनिंग नेटवर्क दिस इंडिविजुअल्स एंड ग्रुप ऑफ फार्मर्स हु आर कंजर्विंग दिस डाइवर्सिटी. सो अभी व्हाट इज नेक्स्ट स्टेज. सो आज आप सब लोग ये प्रोग्राम का एक हिस्सा बन गए हैं बिकॉज यू वांट टू डू समथिंग फॉर दिस एंड बी पार्ट ऑफ दिस सिस्टम. सो हु कैन पार्टिसिपेट, हु कैन बी पार्ट ऑफ मिशन. फार्मर हाउ कैन कंट्रीब्यूट फॉर कल्टीवेशन, कंजर्वेशन एंड मल्टीप्लिकेशन. बैकयार्ड गार्डनर्स फॉर वेजिटेबल डाइवर्सिटी, कंजर्वेशन एंड मल्टीप्लिकेशन. डेवलपिंग लिंकेजेस. स्टूडेंट्स कैन प्ले वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट रोल इन दिस प्रोग्राम. इसमें स्टूडेंट का रोल बहुत ही इंपॉर्टेंट है क्योंकि डॉक्यूमेंटेशन, स्काउटिंग एंड देन सम फील्ड लेवल रिसर्च. स्टूडेंट फ्रॉम स्कूल्स to college to institutions, everyone can be part of this program. Researcher now need to do work on molecular level study, genomic level work, nutrition, everything that that is through researchers and research studies possible to take as a program. Consumers, then documentary maker, NGOs, CSRs, because now need to focus on developing opportunities for this livelihood and nutrition through indigenous means. So CSR can play a major role in any part of country. So these are some activities जिससे ये कैसे कर सकते हैं. गैप ब्रिज होना बहुत ही इंपॉर्टेंट है रूरल एंड अर्बन का. डेवलपिंग नेटवर्क एंड लिंकेजेस अमंग डिफरेंट स्टेक होल्डर्स. ऑर्गेनाइजिंग वर्कशॉप्स एंड ट्रेनिंग भी पार्ट ऑफ दिस प्रोग्राम. पॉपुलराइजेशन ऑफ दिस इंडिजिनियस थ्रू ऑर्गेनाइजिंग इवेंट्स एंड इवेंट्स एंड फेस्टिवल्स एट डिफरेंट लोकेशंस. क्योंकि जब तक ये पॉपुलर नहीं होगा अर्बन लेवल पे इट्स वेरी डिफिकल्ट टू क्रिएट अ मार्केट. सो दैट ये गैप ब्रिज करने के लिए इवेंट बहुत ही इंपॉर्टेंट काम करेंगे. सो थैंक यू फॉर गिविंग मी ए अपॉर्चुनिटी एंड आई होप वी ऑल कैन जॉइन हैंड टुगेदर टू कंजर्व दिस अमेजिंग डाइवर्सिटी ऑफ अ कंट्री एंड गिव अ गुड मैसेज एंड डेवलप समथिंग गुड फॉर ऑल.
Thank you, Sanjay, for an excellent presentation and some amazing insights. And I believe, Ram Prasad, you can unmute Girish as well.
Yes, sir.
As we conclude this very interesting webinar and interesting talk, I am looking at this as a small door which is open to a very amazing world. This world where BIOF is doing some sterling work over many, many years. Huh? They say you are what you eat, correct? And I had asked Sanjay to actually run a small quiz. In fact, I told him that you pose this question. Somebody needs to mute. There is some disturbance. So the whole context of the quiz was asking people to name the different rice varieties that they have eaten, as in the breeds or the types of rices, or the mangoes that they have eaten. And I think the answer would give absolute insights of an urban mind as to how we look at this particular aspect. What I surmise, and a small discussion with Ram Prasad earlier, what I realize is that yes, in my presentation I talk about disconnect of an urban individual with his natural world, but there is also another disconnect of an urban individual with the rural population. Somebody needs to mute. Who's that? Please. So the point is, that will give us our answer. लाल तांदूळ खाल्लेला आहे पनवेल पेंटच्या भागामध्ये वी इज टू गेट दिस रेड व्हरायटी और आय एम शुअर वी इज टू गेट अ सर्टन कॉर्न विच इज नाव रिप्लेस्ड एंटायरली बाय स्वीट कॉर्न इन आसाम आय हॅड द अपॉर्च्युनिटी टू ईट ब्लॅक राईस वॉट आय एम ट्राईंग टू एम्फसाइज हिअर इज दॅट दिस डिस्कनेक्ट मेक्स अस लुक ऍट अन अर्बन एरिया differently, and for us the rural areas are only manufacturing hubs, and our palate is absolutely influenced by the glitz and marketing. As Sanjay said, our platter has narrowed down to just a few cereals and a few fruits. I cannot think beyond a hapus and a pairi when I talk about mangoes. It is nothing but basmati. So the kind of issues which are raised here is how we can have a connect, not just to the rural areas, but to this particular diversity of our own region. In Marathi, I think we say, idhar dha kosavar bhasha badalte, boli bhasha. You know, our dialect changes. Marathi alters as we go, travel towards Goa or travel towards Vidarbha. I think the same way Sanjay explained that the seed varieties go on altering with distances. And I was amazed to know that India alone has thousands and thousands of varieties of rice. And I can't count beyond Ambemore, Basmati, Kola. So I think first and foremost is this very important aspect of knowing what our area has, identifying and connecting. There were some very nice questions which got tossed up. One way to address this disconnect would be to create more awareness of the diversity of a particular region. And I think BIOF is doing some great work there. There was a question which came up specifically. May I read it out? Girish, are you listening in?
Yeah, I'm listening.
So, exactly. Like, there is one particular question here. The production of indigenous varieties largely depend on a market which is mostly demand driven. How to ensure that the demand is sustainable and would increase? Also, considering various cultural diversities, I have seen wheat chapati being softer is more popular among school children than Nagli. One thing which I wanted to add here before Girish takes over to this question is that it is also our training and upbringing and our exposure. I think, shall we start with this question, Girish?
Yeah, sure, we can. There are two things. One is, yes, demand is very important and we have to find a way of connecting production with demand. And there are two ways in which this can be done. Number one is, of course, in the local areas where it is produced, it is important to be increase that awareness that this is available. We have seen in areas in South Gujarat where for the first time we introduced making locally practiced cuisine, the recipes that were traditionally used in the local areas, when we helped women in self-help groups to form their own outlets, food outlets, which served only traditional cuisine, which was made from the local resource, local, like Nagli roti. There was somebody was mentioning about the Nagli roti. Then we found that there was a tremendous patronage received to these type of outlets because people who knew about it were not getting it available, having it available. And for those who were new, consumers for that type of a food, for them it was something which slowly helped to develop the taste. Now what you are saying is right, and what Sanjeev was saying, that for children it will take some time for, because they have been used and the upbringing they have is probably with only wheat. But wheat also, you know that there are certain varieties which are much better health-wise. For example, there was earlier a question about whether there is gluten-free wheat. There is gluten-free wheat. There are wheat like Khapli, which has a much better quality. But slowly the production of these varieties is also going out of fashion, and we need to restore that. And even this is available, it will be a better choice among wheat also. But if you make available millets and you make millet food as some sort of a practice you introduce in your home, maybe not every day, but part of the time, maybe twice in a week you can have that, and slowly the value of it, the quality of it, the taste of it will slowly get acceptance. So it is a matter of upbringing. But at the same time, it is important to connect with consumer demand. So not only in local areas, the urban consumer is one of the largest markets, and an awareness and consciousness of health is something which is coming fast to the urban consumer. And I think we have to find a way by which it will be possible to create. I know the Kirloskars in Pune have done a fantastic job in terms of having an eco bazaar, which creates this type of a connect between rural producers and urban consumers of these type of varieties, which are part of conservation programs. But that happens once a year. So we have to find out ways how this can become a more regular type of availability and a connection. And that is something Arthiji is there, and she had that question. So I think we have to find out way by which a regular connect can be made possible. There is also understanding that the consumer has to develop towards what is produced and the value of that. And we should have a way by which a connect between the producer, the consumer and the producer is also made possible, and that what is popularly known as consumer supported agriculture. So we have to find ways in which we can create these type of connections. Sanjay can add more on how it can be done, but this is the way by which I think we can create a difference. It is not an overnight job. It will take time, but it is something if all of us put our hands to the oar, I'm sure we will be able to cross this present challenge. Sanjay, would you like to add something?
Thank you so much. The important aspect which I think we need to look at is food production was always for an individual, correct? So it was the individual which was growing food for his immediate needs. Then it went to the community, but now we are looking at the market. So I believe when this scale up or upscale production kind of a thing is happening, all the market forces are coming in, and no manufacturing area can sustain such a market demand. So probably it probably is a good idea to have decentralized areas wherein not everybody wants only basmati, because no area can supply such a demand. So if we are able to develop our palate, I'm just talking about a scenario wherein our palate is ready to accept the local varieties and not aim only for a certain variety, because then it will become an industrial farming. And somebody raised a very nice question there about industrialization and standardization of produce. And I felt that standardization and industrialization is probably a convenience. Aren't we all different? Isn't the crop which is being grown, harvested in a certain area going to be a little different from another area, perhaps of the same state or a different state? So mass production to feed the urban palate of a certain variety cannot be the answer, is it? Girish, what do you have to say?
Yeah, I surely agree with what you are saying. I think it is a matter of developing the palate, but at the same time, it is also a matter of availability. Because very often, and the two sort of reinforce each other and feed each other. So yes, we have to work on both the fronts.
I think it makes sense, conservation of, so I, what we probably discussed earlier, that we shall look at this only as a door opening to a different world. And I'm sure we will invite all our participants for their thoughts as to how this can be developed further as a definite connect and a program. So I believe one good idea would be to create a connect between the urban population and their rural brethren via the food. that will be an introduction not only to the food which is grown there, which is our own, but it will also be an introduction to the culture which Sanjay and you, both of you, have talked so exemplarily. So that can be one connect. Can there be smaller hubs which can develop in individual areas? Because what probably works in Maharashtra in a certain area may not exactly work in a different biogeographical area, as you mentioned. So can there be a different kind of a system? Probably BIOF can conduct, we talked about ongoing workshops or ongoing training or designing a tailor-made program for certain requirements or a centralized agency which sort of looks after all this, or creating a different kind of a consumer base in an urban context which can create this connect. So I believe the avenues can be multiple. It can be a bridge, and the food can be such a beautiful bridge. Introduction to the local areas, customs, and also the culture. When you talked about destruction or degradation of our biodiversity, I think you also talked about erosion of our cultural values and how it's all getting decimated as we start being absolutely equal. The other question which came up was, as a consumer, where can we buy such rice, vegetables in Thane? So probably we may not have region-specific answers, but yes, there are a lot of agencies which are working, and I'm sure Girish will be able to throw some more light on it. If there is a greater demand, certain such setups and areas can definitely be created, which will cater to specific demands. Girish, Sanjay, either of you.
Yeah, there are a lot of groups working on this. In fact, I replied to one of the questions. There was some request about varieties which would be relevant in Konkan area. So, in fact, I was responding that we are in touch with a number of groups which are working in Sindhudurg, which are working on indigenous varieties there. So, we could connect with that. And, of course, beyond BIOF network also, there are many. So, Sanjay, would you like to
say something? Yes, sir. I had a database of seed savers, grain producers, and these grassroots innovators and seed banks in different parts of Maharashtra. So, definitely, hum unke saath connect aapko kar sakte hain.
Second question is, there is one more question which has come up, which is, I think, right here. Yeah, it's from Monica. It is about industrialization demands or looks for consistent produce and promote specific crops and types. And basically, does not promote diversity and focuses on uniformity and mass production. How does indigenous crop ensure that the farmers could go for indigenous crops along with ensuring farmers' economic development and contribution to the industrialized world? I think the answer has, in a way, given by Girish, but then if you would like to elaborate, Girish.
Maybe Sanjay can give a little more on this. Sanjay?
Role of indigenous crops and varieties, not only marketing, it has a different aspect, as we discussed, the climate change, food security for the communities, and then livelihood aspect. Industrialization agriculture ka ek udharan main dena chahta hun isme. Jaise Pune ke nearby areas, there are more than 50 different types of rice variety exist 20 year back. Abhi yadi dekhenge, there is only one rice variety called Indrayani, and spread is all over in Mawal and other blocks. So it has, because of industrialization, that means consumer demand, all rice variety has totally gone, and there is no any variety which can grow in deep water, in early harvesting, and even very late harvesting. So industrial agriculture ki wajah se ye sari diversity khatam ho chuki hai. Abhi we have to change in different way. We have to रिस्पेक्ट द डाइवर्सिटी. अभी सिर्फ फार्मिंग कम्युनिटी ने डाइवर्सिटी का रिस्पेक्ट करना नहीं है, अलॉन्ग विद दैट कंज्यूमर्स ऑल्सो रिस्पेक्ट द डाइवर्सिटी, क्योंकि फूड प्लेट में वो नहीं आएगी तो डिमांड नहीं बढ़ेगा, और डिमांड नहीं बढ़ेगा तो कल्टीवेशन नहीं होगा. तो ये सारी चीजें जुड़ी हुई है. सेकंड जो है रीजन स्पेसिफिक एंड सीजन स्पेसिफिक, ये भी अप्रोच इसमें ध्यान में रखना बहुत जरूरी है. देन फ्रॉम फार्मिंग कम्युनिटी परस्पेक्टिव, इसमें हमें प्रोडक्शन सरप्लस प्रोडक्शन फॉर मार्केट मार्केटिंग एंड देन सम वैरायटीज फॉर सेल्फ कंजम्पशन एंड रिस्क मिटिगेशन. तो डाइवर्सिटी नीड टू मेंटेन इन द फील्ड ऑल्सो एंड देन इन द मार्केट ऑल्सो.
गिरीश, एनीथिंग एल्स ऑन टॉप ऑफ दैट?
No, I think that should be fine.
That should be. I think let us look at this as an eye-opener or a window to a very different world. We'll try and get our thoughts organized around the issues which got tossed up. I'm sure the participants can also offer their inputs. There cannot be a quick fix or the same fix for every issue. Somebody talked about how farmers in a certain area are required to grow only watermelons because of economic compulsions. So I believe the kind of awareness activities that BIOF is doing, and probably one such step that jointly we did via this webinar, is also important. But rather than such things happening at an urban area for a different reason, they can also happen similarly in the rural context, where that is exactly where things are happening, because that is where things are happening. So it is probably one thing leading to another, a consumer demand driving the production in rural areas or our agricultural areas, that in turn influencing. So you don't really know how to break that cycle. And I believe the kind of activities that BIOF is carrying out is a step in the right direction. Let us take this next step. Probably there can be specific webinars or workshops which are directed not only to the urban people but to a rural population, as the case may be, if it is brought out and if it is within your jurisdiction. Or you could selectively train such individuals at BIOF. I think even that is a distinct possibility. So those who raise that kind of a question can get in touch with BIOF. That is what I would suggest. And I'm sure the farmers in that area would definitely benefit by insight. And let's see, collate all this information, take this a step further, invite some feedback from our participants. I'm sure we have some very learned people in the audience today, and they can offer such wonderful insights and thought processes to aid this particular activity further. Is there anything else coming in? More about local targeting. Can you see the last question, please, Girish?
What is it? Can you read it? I'm just trying to go there.
Oh, okay. It says indigenous crops and diversity is more about local targeting. So would it not be and should not be displaced from its original place? I think both Sanjay and Girish answered that question.
Yeah.
I think so, correct?
Yeah, in a way, yes. We answered also, and I would like to supplement. You see, localization, decentralization is the real catchword for the future development of most of the endeavors that we have. And so also it applies to the varieties. So we are talking of actually not again going to a local variety produced in Jawhar or in Palghar and producing it in such large quantities that it is taken all over the country. No, it is probably relevant in niche consumer areas which can be accessed from Jawhar. So there would be various other locations where there would be locally relevant varieties which have to be tapped. And in that sense, this whole effort has to be multiplied, has to become a plural effort, and has to become a very, very localized effort. Therefore, it has to become a movement. And it is not as if, you know, you produce basmati and the whole world eats basmati. So we need to see that the diversity that we are talking of becomes a diversity in production, in localization, and in consumption. So I agree with you.
One important point which got tossed up that I think even Sanjay mentioned was that the conservation of seeds actually is a live thing. It cannot be preserved as an archive or a document. So it needs to be planted and grown. And one particular solution which got tossed up between when we sort of discussed was a typical urban farmer. And whether an urban farmer can be a small connect in this particular activity and movement.
Sanjeev, I think you brought up that point, which is also important, because urban farming is also coming up not so much for production of cereals, but for production of vegetables. It is becoming quite important, or even production of herbs. So I think there is one thing that probably this urban farmer category can adopt in a major way, is that the type of variety that we have of vegetables in the rural areas, there are a number of community persons, resource persons, seed savers who are also working on producing seed of these vegetables. And I think the urban farmer can make use of these seeds, which are of a wide range, wide variety of different types of vegetables, and which would be nutritionally, which have been shown to be nutritionally much better. And that is something which can be grown by the urban farmer for self-consumption, or maybe for a local clientele. I think a lot of such connects are possible. So it is not getting connected with the urban areas as urban areas being consumers, but also urban areas being producers using the seed resource that is available from these niche areas. So Sanjay, would you like to say a little bit about the seed production that we have initiated in some parts of Maharashtra?
We had started seed production of around 25 different vegetable crops, which can be possible to cultivate in urban gardens or nutrition garden, backyard gardens or terrace garden. And we are supplying at present more than 15,000 seed kits we had supplied to Pune, Mumbai and nearby areas. And demand is growing. And for that, we are doing germination test and physical purity and possibility to adapt at that situation. So that type of connect is possible with these groups, and definitely we can supply these types so that in that seasonal then in that there is a diversity of vegetable crops which can grow in different seasons. That is different seasonal aspect. And second aspect is early, late, mid late and very late, so that year round availability of different beans possible to cultivate and a part of food plate.
Fantastic. I think that sort of summarizes in a way. And what we can do at our end is we will take a look at all the different aspects which got thrown up, collect them, streamline that. Hopefully our participants will share their thoughts, some ideas from their end, and if that can be integrated, I think it will open up doors to further collaborative activities. Like the urban farmer is one such possibility. The urban population as the consumer is another possibility. Education and awareness to local groups under the BIOF umbrella is another possibility. I think a lot of possibilities will emerge. It's probably a small step at this particular point in time, but I'm sure it's going to be a wonderful journey in the days to come. So shall we say that as we come to a conclusion of this session, it is going to be the beginning of some wonderful journey into this world? If most of the questions have been taken up. And what can be done is, if there are some very, very specific questions, of course, it cannot get answered, but they can be answered separately later.
Sanjeev, I suggest that some unanswered questions could be responded as a follow-up to this webinar. And there are some action points which also would emerge out of the suggestions.
Correct.
So one could create some sort of action directions out of this. Huh. And we could get back to the participants so that whoever is interested in particular actions, activities, or engagement, that can be made possible.
Fantastic. So I think let's come to a conclusion in a way. Conclusion only of this particular session. And like we said, that this is going to open up doors to some wonderful, wonderful things to happen. We invite each and every one of you to share your thoughts and ideas about a lot of these points which got tossed up. How to create a better connect? What could be the different topics which could be considered? And I'm sure BIAF, with its diversity of talent, can definitely offer enough guidance and help and support to sort of centralize and get these activities together. So on that note, I think we should thank all the participants for their time. Of course, a very big thank you to Shri Sanjay Patil, and of course, Girish, to you, Ram Prasad, and everyone from the Untamed Earth who actually made this webinar possible. And we say in Marathi, आम्ही म्हणतो की आम्ही जातो असं म्हणत नाही, येऊ का असं आपण म्हणतो आणि रजा घेतो, कारण येऊ का म्हटल्यानंतर आपण नक्की पुन्हा भेटणार असतो आणि आपण जरूर भेटूया. फिजिकल मीट्स आर नॉट पॉसिबल, बट आय एम शुअर वी कॅन मीट वाया सच अ मीडियम विथ सम व्हेरी इंटरेस्टिंग टॉपिक्स फ्रॉम आर नॅचरल वर्ल्ड. अँड वन वुड बी ऑफकोर्स कन्सर्निंग वॉट वी डिस्कस टुडे. सो टिल देन आय थँक ईच अँड एव्हरी वन ऑफ यू. से goodbye momentarily, and we shall be in touch. But we are also requesting you to share your thoughts, your feedback, your ideas on what got discussed in this wonderful webinar and an amazing world of BIAF and our indigenous seeds. With these words, I would like to take your leave. Thank you so much. Good day to you all, and greetings to each and every one of our Independence Day tomorrow. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.